guys, welcome to the green room. We are backstage at Madison Square Garden with John Summit. How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. It's a big day for you.
Oh yeah.
How are you feeling?
I'm feeling good. I thought I'd be way more nervous than I am, but I mean, I've been preparing for the set for at least 6 months now, and everything's fully locked in. So all I gotta do is perform now.
All you gotta do is get out there. Do you get nervous at all before you go on stage?
I mean, I get nervous for every set, to be honest. Like, even if it's like 50 people, I get pretty nervous. So this is like, what, 20,000? So I should be a little bit more nervous than I am. But I've been throwing parties all week already in New York, so I'm pretty comfortable right now.
I love that. 50 people or 20,000, you still got those nerves.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I like nerves, because if you don't have nerves, it means you don't care.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So how are you liking New York?
I mean, I love New York. It like kind of stresses me out a little bit because there's so much going on at all times. Mm-hmm. I'm from Chicago, which feels like a smaller New York. But I mean, it's been amazing. Like, the people, the energy. I'm a big foodie, so the food's great. Mm-hmm. And yeah, the weather's been nuts. So, you know, throw like these boat parties and stuff has been fun.
I know. I saw your boat party. You guys were like partying right next to like Lady Liberty.
Yeah, that was. I've never seen Statue of Liberty in person before.
Oh my God.
I was a little unimpressed. It was a little smaller in person. But.
Yeah, she's not as big as you might think, exactly, but you know, she's a queen.
She's still a queen.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I was a little worried we were going to tip over the boat though, because like some waves hit us on the side and like the whole crowd was like falling over left and right. But. Yeah, that could have been like a PR disaster.
Yeah. And floating in the Hudson River. I've really loved watching your rise of your career, especially over the last couple of months, ever since Coachella. It's been pretty amazing. And a lot of people think, you know, or people can assume that it was an overnight success, but you've been at this for a very long time.
Yeah. I mean, I've been releasing music for 8 years now. I've been producing for double that amount. Been DJing for twice as long. So yeah, I've been doing this for a while. But I think because like dance music, especially like underground dance music, is very niche, and that if you're not in the scene, you don't know. Because we don't have,
right.
We're not big on Spotify and like not on the radio. Like, it wasn't until recently my tracks got on the radio. So it's funny when people say overnight success, but for every overnight success is the 10 years that takes to make it happen.
Your debut album, Comfort and Chaos, comes out July 12th. How are you feeling? Are you so excited to put this out into the world?
Yeah, that was like the most hell I've ever been through, was putting that album together. Because, I mean, I've just been doing singles for 8 years, and I didn't really have to make an album because I was successful. But all my favorite artists all have, you know, albums, and then something I've always wanted to do. And made a lot of music that people don't expect from me on it. So I am I'm more nervous about putting that out than playing Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, because you are known for like dance, fun music, and this new album shows a little bit more of a vulnerable side of you. You put more of your emotion into it, and people are going to hear a little bit more of your story, which is pretty cool. Was it hard for you to open up in that way, or does it kind of just come out of you, or do you have to do like mental prep? Like,
well, it was hard because I mean, I was on the road for like 4 years straight of just, you know, playing every single weekend, like 5 nights a week. And so I was making just like dance floor party tracks, which are easy to make because you know they're going to work.
Totally.
And I finally took a month off to actually write these tracks and get more introspective with it and kind of tap into more of my more emotional side. And like, because on stage, I'm John Summit, the performer, but at home, I'm John Schuster, which is my real name. And I didn't make, you know, kind of more rainy day music and stuff until that period of time, and it turned out pretty good, I think.
Does the fact that you have your stage name John Summit and then John Schuster, is that separation nice? Like, is it good to have that balance, because you can kind of know who you are on stage and then know who you are off of it?
Yeah, it's like a double-edged sword, right? Where it's like, I'm pretty like introverted and stuff in real life, so, but then when I go on stage, I can turn the John Summit brain on and become this big performer and play in front of 100,000 people, and I'm totally fine with it. But when you're touring and playing every night, you kind of get lost in that, and you kind of forget who you are a little bit. And so I've been trying to take more time off lately and seeing family and friends and like get, and then I think I make better music when I get out of that zone, because that's more of the performing zone. You know what I mean?
Totally. And I feel like whenever you spend time with friends and family that knew you before you were John Summit.
Yes.
It really like not only humbles you, but it puts you find yourself again and find what makes you happy, find your joy. And
totally. And they treat me like a normal person too. And they, you know, yes. They make fun of me and they like hey, keep me, you know, humble and stuff.
Yeah, they don't care who you are. Exactly. They'll still make fun of you. I love that. The lead single, Go Back, featuring Julia Church. That song is incredible. I love it. Was that one of the songs that you previewed at Coachella?
Yeah, so I played that at Coachella, I think, for the first time. And the reaction was absolutely wild, because I made that one in London with Sub Focus, and he's one of the most legendary drum and bass producers of all time. And I kind of headed him up with the song idea because I had this vocal with Julia. And then, you know, we had the idea of doing both house and drum and bass on the same record, which is kind of like the whole concept of Comfort and Chaos of the album, is the duality, you know, kind of the same thing with the Cascade collab, how it starts off all emotional and beautiful, then it has a big techno drop. So the reaction to that one's been nuts.
I love that. I love the Comfort and Chaos kind of messaging. I think it's awesome. I feel like the name on everyone's lips at Coachella was John Summit. Like, seriously. I just know so many people that loved your set so much, and you also previewed so many of your songs that are on this new album. And I know that you love music festivals, you love performing them, but you also used to go to music festivals just as a viewer as well.
I still kind of do, I guess, because when I'm at Coachella, I'm still going every single day.
Okay, I love that. So what's the biggest difference of going to a music festival versus performing at a music festival?
Well, I mean, it's the total opposite experience, but I think you don't know what to do as a performer unless you go. I mean, because I went for so many years, I kind of know exactly what I like in a performance. I mean, as soon as I finished the Everything I Always Set with Dom Dahl, I went in the crowd and saw Justice, and I was just taking notes the whole time because their lighting show is incredible. Because I know I have the music and stuff down. I guess I always went as a fan, but I was always kind of like mentally studying performances because the whole act of performing just fascinates me.
What was like the first time that you were like, okay, I want to DJ, I want to do this, I want to see how it works to make this music?
So I went to Law. Palooza every year growing up. Yeah, like seeing Deadmau5 in the Pouring Rain in 2011, this is what really inspired me to go all in on DJing, because I realized that it's more than just DJing. You can do a whole show, a whole production. Mm-hmm. And then I'm debuting I teased it at Coachella and in Toronto last weekend, but this is like the full debut of the Comfort and Chaos kind of arena show production today. And that's been inspired by, you know, when you think of Daft Punk, Justice, Deadmau5, all these legendary electronic acts. I think that's what is really cool about what we do.
I also too, with you, I think you, I love your work because not only do you make amazing music, but there's also so much that goes into this industry besides just the music.
Yep.
And your social media game kills it. You're hilarious on Twitter.
Yeah.
Your TikToks are awesome. And you have your event company. There's so many aspects to your career. And I think it's very smart. And is there a strategy behind your social media, or is it just kind of who you are?
Well,
you just love to post on Twitter all the time.
So I've been tweeting since like 2012, and I was pretty much just tweeting into the void the first 6 years where I got no likes on anything. But then I was like releasing music, and I never changed my personal to the professional handle or whatever, my artist handle. Cause I just like flipped John Schuster to John Summit, but I was still tweeting just like I'm, you know, kind of just me. And I think the fans and stuff really gravitated towards that, where I feel like everyone else is so professional and takes themselves so seriously.
Totally.
When, I take my music really seriously, but at the end of the day, you know, I'm throwing parties, we're having fun, like, life's not that serious.
It's not that serious. You're a real human, and people love to see that. How does it feel that Barack Obama knows who you are?
It's nuts. Yeah, because he placed Where You Are as one of his favorite tracks of the year. And I'm just trying to envision what setting he listens to the track.
I'm doing the same
thing.
Do you
think it's like his daughters that put him on or something? Like, ahead of it.
It's probably his daughters putting him on, and like, I can just see him like maybe making a coffee in the kitchen, and that's okay. Just like what he's doing. Or maybe he's on the treadmill. I feel like Obama works out a little bit.
You don't think he sneakily goes out to nightclubs, puts like a little mask on or something?
I would be, imagine you're like at the club, or you're performing and Barack Obama's in the front row. Like,
yeah, I mean, I should have put him on guest list for tonight. tonight. Who knows?
Totally. Maybe you come backstage, come have a drink in the green room.
Oh, yeah.
That's awesome. Whenever that happened, were your parents like freaking out?
Yeah, it's like things like that where they're like, oh, this is the real deal. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I can play big festivals and stuff, but they won't even know what the festivals are. But then they see, like, I get like 4 was 30 to 30. And then, you know, they're like, oh, so you're putting your business degree to good work. I'm like, I guess.
Yeah, it's always interesting to see like what parents like because you, like you said, you know, you could be could be performing the biggest festival, but it's like these little things. Really little. I mean, 4 30 under 30 is like incredible. Congratulations.
Yeah,
but it's
cool.
Funny. I love that. I'm sure they're so proud of you.
Oh, yeah. They're here tonight too, so it's gonna be a lot of fun.
Awesome. I saw this clip of you, how you have never gotten flowers for a girl before.
Yes.
did you know that would take off in the way it did?
Well, it's also because I don't like date girls and stuff like that, so it kind of made me look bad, where it's like, if I've been dating girls, I still don't give them flowers. But yeah, I guess that was a pretty dumb comment.
Honestly, like looking, I looked at it from like a perspective of like seeing your side, and I'm like, it's fine. I understand. Like you didn't know, but now you know.
No, I know. I'm a little too old to have not known that, but you know, you have to figure out eventually.
But guess what? You know what you did? You took action.
Yes.
You got flowers yourself and you gave them to everyone you work with.
Yep.
How'd that make you feel, and how'd that make them feel?
Well, I was surprised like how happy they were about it. I'm like, that's all I have to do is just give flowers, and it makes people that happy. So I'm going to start doing it more often, I think.
Now you know. What's your favorite flower?
I'm still trying to figure out I don't know my flower types.
You don't know.
I need to do some research.
You don't know the difference between tulip, sunflower, tulip, sunflower, hydrangea.
I know what a sunflower is. I know what a rose is. Yeah. I've seen The Bachelor before. Yeah. I always thought like a rose was like, kind of like, will you marry me kind of thing. So I'm like,
So this is The Bachelor's fault. Okay.
Yes. This is not my fault.
That's so funny. If you could work with any other artist that is outside of your genre, maybe it's country, maybe it's rap, who would it be?
That's a tough question, because I mean, I like to try to find smaller artists who are more like unknown and unheard. Mm-hmm. Like Halo, for example, she was in 7 different bands at once before going into electronic music and stuff. And I got connected to her through Cascade, but like finding like a new act like that. And now she's a huge act, and she's the special guest tonight as well. And she's just such a massive talent. So I think using my platform to kind of put new people on, that's why I have my label Experts Only too, where I think that's more fun to me. Mm-hmm.
The smaller stuff and the journey. I love that.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about Experts Only and how it's been having this company and these events.
It's awesome, because the way I got put on is that I was releasing music through other underground labels that, you know, took a risk in me, because I didn't have a following and stuff when I first signed records. I didn't have, you know, a big social media presence or anything. And I feel like it'd be stupid that I can't do the same for other producers that send me such amazing music. And like, I'm playing a 5-hour set tonight. Half the music is my music, but the other half is most of these artists on the label that I've signed and this new music I dig for every day. I mean, I get like 300 demos a day now, which is nuts.
That's insane.
So it's hard to filter through that.
I'm sure it is, but all you need is that one that you find.
Exactly.
I gotta let you get ready for tonight, because 5 hours?
Yes.
Damn.
And then I have a 3-hour after party set, so I got a full 8-hour shift tonight.
Okay, well, someone needs to drink a Red Bull, but yeah. I have to ask, do you have any pre-show rituals?
Usually just a few shots of tequila, and that's what gets me going.
I love that. Bring the energy, get
exactly.
it going.
But besides that, literally up until 10 minutes before the set, like I got my laptop here, I'm working and changing every little detail because I'm very neurotic. But then once I'm 10 minutes out, close the laptop, export my USBs, take my tequila shots, and I get on stage.
I love that. Well, thank you so much for coming to Rolling Stones, the Green Room, and we'll see you tonight. I'm
so excited.
Can't wait.
Thanks for having me.